Hello and welcome to another Making It video. My name's Jane. I'm an artist educator here at the Andy Warhol Museum, and today I'm going to be showing you how to make a digital transparency for screen printing. Screen printing was probably Warhol's most used medium during his career, and he was fascinated by it. Quote, "With silk screening, you can pick a photograph, blow it up, transfer it and glue onto silk, and then roll it across so that the ink goes through the silk, but not through the glue. That way you get the same image, slightly different each time. It was so simple, quick, and chancy. I was thrilled with it." The materials you'll need for this tutorial are a computer, a source image, and any version of Photoshop. Optionally, you can also get acetate paper and use a laser jet printer to print out our finished images. Nowadays, screen printing is still widely used. Today, screens are made with polyester as opposed to silk, and the process involves taking a transparency or film positive like the ones we'll be making today, and using it in combination with emulsion, a photosensitive material to burn or expose an image onto a screen. Without an emulsion coating, any ink goes straight through onto the other side of the screen. However, if we coat a screen with emulsion with the image placed beneath it, and then expose it to light from something like a light table or sunlight, the emulsion will harden except for where the screen was covered by the image. What we're left with, after washing it, is a screen that can print the image that was burned onto it. Today we'll be learning how to make that image, which is called a transparency. Warhol appropriated, which is to use without permission, images from many different sources for a lot of his early work. He would take an already existing image from magazines, newspapers, or advertisements, and then have screens made of that image. He also paid particular attention to contrast, cropping, and color, which we'll be doing with our images today. The first thing to do will be to source an image that you want to use. This can be from a magazine, newspaper, the internet, or even just a picture that's already on your phone. We're going to be using this image of Andy with spiky hair, but really any image will do. When selecting an image, try to pick one with a high resolution. An image's resolution just means how many pixels wide and long the image is. For this, we're going to be using Photoshop. To start, first open Photoshop and click File, New. This should open a dialog box where we can name our file Andy, and then set the dimensions for the size of our transparency. For a small transparency, sized for about the sheet of regular printing paper, you'll want to select 8.5 by 11 inches. For a larger acetate, you'll select 13 by 19 inches. You can choose your size based on what limitations your printer has. Depending on your version of Photoshop, the dimensions may show up in terms of pixels or centimeters instead of inches. Don't worry if that's the case. All you need to do is click the drop-down menu and select inches. Finally, set the color mode to grayscale so that the image we're working with is already in black and white. Congratulations! Now you have your canvas ready. The next thing we're going to want to do is take our source image and drop it in this Photoshop canvas. You can do this by opening your source image in Photoshop, and then select Edit, Copy, then go back to the empty canvas you created, and then select Edit, Paste. When you paste your photo, it may be too small or too large. To fix this, select the source image you pasted and then select Edit, Free Transform. This will let you change the size of the image by clicking and dragging any of the quarters of the image that you can see here. Once you're happy with the scale of your image, make sure you hit Enter, and our image is now ready to make some changes. At this point, we're ready to adjust the brightness and contrast. You may want to experiment with the values until there's less gray to make sure the image is easy to print and create our bitmap. To do this, select Image, Adjustments, and then pick Brightness, Contrast. You may need to experiment until you're happy with the result. But once you are, we're going to halftone the image to prepare it for printing. To do this, select Image, Mode, Bitmap. If for some reason the bitmap option is grayed out for you, make sure you have your image selected and not the brightness contrast adjustment layer. There'll be two different layers. It'll ask you to flatten the layers and then hit OK. For resolution, select 300 as the output to match the DPI we selected while creating our canvas. Then, under the Method drop-down menu, select Halftone and then hit OK. Next, we're going to select the frequency of the halftones, which is expressed as lines per inch. This determines how large or how small the dots are that make up our image. You can experiment with the values and see what you like the most, but in general, you never want to go above 30, as these dots will be too small to print effectively. Remember, The smaller the number, the larger the dots. For this project, let's use 25. Leave the angle at 45 for now, because that will affect our dot matrix angle. You're free to choose any shape that'll make up the dots, but round is the most common, so we'll stick with that. Congratulations, you now have a bitmapped image. You'll want to zoom into your image using Control Plus on Windows or Command Plus on Mac to see what it'll look like when it's printed. If you're not happy with how it looks, no worries. All you have to do is select Edit, Undo Bitmap, and this will revert your image to the previous state, and you can try the same steps with different frequencies and shapes until you find something you're happy with. Now, the next part is completely optional, but if you want to touch up your image so that there's less of these extra halftones, you can create a mask to get rid of them. To do this, we'll first have to convert our final bitmapped image back to grayscale, which may sound confusing, but right now, since the mode is set to bitmap, it won't let us make the changes that we want. To do this, select Image, Mode, Grayscale. A dialog box will show up asking for a size ratio, and we'll just leave that at 1 and select OK. It's important to do these steps because without them, Photoshop won't let us create our clipping mask. Next, we need to unlock our background layer by double-clicking it. Leave all settings as is and click OK. Next, we're going to add a new layer to serve as our background. This should be in white. So to do this, select Layer, New, Layer. Next, with this new layer, select the Paint Bucket tool and make sure the fill color is set to white, and fill the layer. You do this by clicking the image and it should cover up our image in white. Don't panic. All we need to do is move this layer below our image by dragging it below it in the Layers tab. Next, with our image layer selected, hit the Add Layer Mask. This will create our layer mask, which can be used to remove the top part of our image, in this case the portrait, and reveal what's beneath it, which is going to be that white background layer we created. To remove these extra halftones that we want to get rid of, just select the brush tool, or press B, and you'll have two options, either black or white. With black selected, and our masking layer selected, make sure you don't select the image, paint over the layer and it will remove what you paint over. If you make a mistake, don't worry, simply select white, you can hit X to toggle back and forth, and it will add back whatever was removed with the black brush strokes. Do this until you're happy with the final image. And make sure when you're doing your brush strokes, you have the mask selected and not the image. Thanks again for joining me on this screen printing journey and exploring some of Warhol's screen printing techniques that are still used to this day. I hope this inspires you to experiment and create your own screen print designs, and stay tuned for the next episode.